industry. Now, if you have a look at the research that people say we should be doing, it's some of these ones. We need to do research that tracks and analyzes diversity trends in South Africa, the transport sector and the aviation sector. So, tracking and analyzing diversity trends. Who's doing what? What are the numbers? Then we need to do research that works towards identifying and eliminating barriers to achieving professional and diverse workforce. And I think many of you have been talking about what are these big barriers. Again, lots of numbers that we know about in research. We need to do research that seeks to promote career opportunities for women and girls in these areas, and specifically in the fields of science, technology, math, and all of these kinds of technical sides of the thing. And then lastly, and more social science-y kind of research, is the challenging of notions that there are traditional masculine strongholds which are naturally unsuitable for women in the aviation industry. And I think many of you have spoken about that. These are big questions that I found in research. But one of the big problems that I found is that it's all about stats. And now one of the comments this morning is that reading numbers can make you not know what really is going on. It fools you, was the comment. And that really made me think, wow, you guys are really thinking about this. Because how can we move beyond just numbers? So, where do we start? Right, so as a social scientist, where do we start looking at people? And I'm hoping it's okay if I take this off and just start walking around a little bit, because I just feel that it constrains me, right? Okay, so. As people, we tend to think in terms of what we call binary opposite. And then the big one that we're talking about today is men and women, male and female. These are binary opposites that people feel comfortable with when talking about identity. But I'm going to say, hell no! We need to move beyond identity politics that feeds into these binary opposites. We need to allow for deep narratives. This is something that some of you were speaking about. And I felt that I was just challenging you guys when you were saying that there's individual stories that we need to know about. It's not just about women in general. We need to know what's going on. Who are these women? What are the stories that they want us to know? We need, in anthropology, we say we need to use the local to explain the global. In this case, we need to use the individual to understand what is going on in the industry. So, how do we do research? Now, as I said, if we look at the research questions that we found, a lot of the time it's about quantitative data. There's nothing wrong with this. We do questionnaires, we're reporting in terms of numbers or percentages, and it helps us to get the big picture. Nothing wrong with this. But numbers are only one side of the story, right? So, for example, we're doing research on ice cream, free ice cream, right? And there's a researcher there in the background and they say, oh, I can see only 1 in 30 people take the free ice cream. This is interesting. Okay, so we know that there are some people that take the ice cream. But what we want to know is, why did you take the free ice cream? How did you feel when you took the free ice cream? What are the reasons why we do the things that we do? So, let's do a little experiment in the room. All the women, please put up your hand. Wow, I'm so impressed. Okay, right? Now, all the women in the room who are here because they want to talk more about gender empowerment in the room, please put up your hand. I was hoping to see more, but okay, we see some. All right, now, of those women who put up your hand, by a show of hands, why do you want to know more? What? I need to ask you, right? I can't just ask by a show of hands, why do you want to know more? Right? There's something more, there's the fleshy bits that we need to find out. And quantitative data gives us the big picture. It says, yes, there are women who are interested, but it doesn't tell us why you are interested. So, when you look at the current research that seeks to understand gender issues in the aviation industry, there's a paucity of what we call qualitative research. And I'm hoping a lot of the questions that you were talking about this morning, we can deal with when you do more qualitative research. And that's the bread and butter of an anthropologist like myself. What are some of the broad features? It analyzes words and images as opposed to numbers. It's about observation rather than experimentation. There's a preference for the meaning rather than the behavior. So for example, we document what we see, what we experience from a local perspective, from the individual's perspective. And frankly, we're saying that there are some things that you just cannot measure. It's not measurable. It's understandable. Some things like attitude, beliefs, practice. For example, if I have to ask you, how much do you love your mother? In percentages. 2.5%? 300%? You know, it's something maybe that we should be measuring in terms of numbers. And many of the issues that we as women deal with in male-dominated industries are those issues that cannot be measured in numbers. What we need are the stories. We need the deep dive. We need to understand what's happening at the grassroots level. So why do we need more qualitative research? As I said, deep narratives. And we can also explain some of these numbers that are out there by contextualizing them with real life examples. And we understand those individual stories. So, let's have a look at some of the issues. Can you see that? I'm hoping. So, some of the issues that we've noticed, that we've been speaking about, what can qualitative research help us to think about? So, gender stereotypes. Women shouldn't be pilots, for example. That's a gender stereotype. So now we can start talking to women, what kind of education did you not get when you started working in the aviation industry? What were the things that you weren't aware of, the knowledge that you needed? Was it just about being at school, or was there other intricacies that you needed to know? For example, this opportunity that you have to share information with a woman who are in the industry who has the knowledge. It's not just about formal education, it's about reaching out to those centers of knowledge that you aren't necessarily available to. Divisions of labor, for example. Women should be in the cabin serving food. We're not saying they shouldn't. We're not saying that the work that they do is not important, but a gender stereotype for many years is that's the contribution that women can do. In this room, just the few minutes that I was sitting in front of you, I learned so much about the agency and the hard work that all of this takes. It's not a gender stereotype. Paying gap, even in my own industry, men earn more than women. Still today, what does that do for women who are alone at home, who have families that they have to support? If they earn less than their male counterparts, why are their lives less important? Let's talk about historical narratives. You were talking about role models. What are the role models at home? The role models in schools, communities, and cultures. And how are you able to tap into those role models? Again, numbers cannot give you this information. We need individual stories of women who have risen above the glass ceiling to be able to tell other women about what you need to do. Some of the things that we were talking about this morning is how gender is performed in the workplace. Enactment of masculinity as the norm, dominant, entrenched traditions that intentionally exclude women. For example, the body and using reproduction as a measure to exclude women from certain areas in the industry. And lastly, we need to understand what those barriers are, the nature of the barriers, and the resilience of women who have transcended these barriers. What are the strategies of resilience and perseverance? What are the impact of policy changes on women in these industries? Not that there is a policy change, but what difference has it made on people's lives? Who should be doing research? Now, one of the things that we've spoken about this morning is gender is not only about women. So it shouldn't be just women doing research about women because it's a women's issue. No, it's a human issue, right? And our research should reflect this. In academic journals, it shouldn't be a journal for women's issues. It should be published in technical journals, journals that other people also read. Gender is not an academic issue. It's not something that's discussed by theorists. Gender issues are issues that we experience day to day. When I walk out of my house into the office, gender is experienced. The effects of gender is experienced. And lastly, what do we do with our research? We need to make it accessible. It cannot end up in a thick document with a fudge factor of 200 when you put it down on the table and there's all this wonderful information in there, but no one has access to it. People should have access to the research that we do, and it should be available to multiple audiences. From the technical to the social, from the boardroom to the village, and we need to translate the research that we do so that it can be taken back to, I think in the front there was an example of their village back home, of young women knowing what it takes to make it, what other women have done to make it, what are the barriers and how they overcame those barriers. Not that we're saying that the barriers are right. We need to change workplace cultures through our research. What are the things that need to be changed? What are the individual stories that help us to change them? And we need to implement legislation and policy through our research. We need to challenge mindsets and make sure that our research reaches the people that can make changes. In forums like these, for example, we have people from across the industry, so the people who make the policies, who sign on the dotted line, can hear individual stories about what it's like to experience this at a daily basis.